Welcome to Telecare's special presentation on the 60th anniversary of the Diocese of Rockville Center. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaughan, joined by my co-host, Bishop Andrzej Szaslewski, Auxiliary Bishop of the Diocese. So it's really quite a big celebration, 60 years, right?
Jim, yes.
Older than us both.
That's right. It is a nice celebration, you know, and when I think of those anniversaries or celebration like this, you know, we're definitely, let's say, with this decade closing like a little chapter in the history of the diocese. 60 years, it's already a wonderful and long time. But I remember during my studies, you know, I heard this great quote by Karl Rahner that, you know, every end is the beginning of something new.
That's so true.
So as we are closing, you know, this decade, it's already six decades, it's a great opportunity for us to take a look to the back of our diocese, all those wonderful things we have achieved. But it's also with our new bishop, Bishop John, right now, you know, it's for us a new beginning. So I think this anniversary, sixth anniversary, is kind of special in the life and the history of our diocese. So I'm excited, and it's nice to be here with you and in this beautiful cathedral to celebrate.
Well, what better place, actually, to do a special about these 60 years than in the cathedral, right? That's such a rich history.
Jim, absolutely right. I think that the cathedral is the heart of the diocese, is the heartbeat of the diocese, a liturgical, or if you will, sacramental, eucharistic heart of the diocese. You know, all the events, major events of the diocese, all anniversaries or whatever we celebrate in the diocese always take place in the cathedral. The cathedral, by its nature and by its name, is the site of the bishop. It's the place of the bishop's chair. So as all the liturgical heartbeat of the diocese is going on here, and we celebrate all the anniversaries, this is the best time and place to celebrate also this anniversary, 60th anniversary of our diocese.
Now, we were ordained by Bishop McGann, but of course there was Bishop Kellenberg too, who was the founding bishop of the diocese, right?
That's right, but yeah, you're right. You may have a recollection of Bishop Kallenberg. I don't. I was also ordained by Bishop McGann. I came to the diocese during Bishop McGann. So the beginning of my priesthood and the first years and the first anniversary, first decades of my priesthood were also with Bishop McGann. And just like you, I was ordained in the same place. And so that cathedral always brings these very sentimental memories of these great, wonderful events.
And then we had Bishop McHugh for such a short time because he got ill right after he came to us, and he helped out in a lot of different ways and left his mark, I think, in a lot of ways. Catholic education, a lot of his dedication to getting things moving in the way of education in our diocese, and kind of caught up with so many different things, don't you think?
Jim, also in the United Nations, I think. You
yes,
may recall
yes.
that he was involved with the work of the Vatican, especially with in the United Nations. And Bishop McHugh was very much in tune with all the pro-life issues. So I think that was a wonderful representation of our activities, as that our diocese was, I think, always very sensitive on this very topic. And, you know, I'm glad that you mentioned him, because to me, in my mind, it was always a misfortune that he didn't have really enough time to get to know the presbyterate or even the faithful of this diocese, and vice versa. You know, I don't think that we ever had really enough time to get to know him and his wonderful spirit and incredible love for the church and all these very crucial topics and issues of the church that he was very much in tune and gave really his life and his time to those issues. And I think that was very incredible. So I do regret the fact that we really didn't have that much time to exchange, get to know each other, you know. And but definitely he make a wonderful, wonderful mark in the life of the presbyterate and the faithful of our diocese. I agree.
And then it was, I guess, in 2001, I guess it was Pope John Paul II at the time, appointed Bishop Murphy to our diocese, who was with us up until last year. And that is, I guess, Bishop Murphy is the bishop that perhaps you and I know the best, and
That's
we've
right.
lived much of our priesthood with Bishop Murphy as well and his leadership.
And let's not forget the fact that you may recall Bishop Murphy was appointed in right after September 11th, so
right.
that was 2001. Actually, you know, his celebration was only a week before September 11th, so it was already, I think, a very rough start, you know, a very challenging time. You know, we all grieved, we all cried, and And Bishop Murphy really started his ministry here in this diocese with that connotation. And I think that this healing time of the September 11 was going on for a while. And I think that was rough, but you're right, he has this wonderful stretch of the life of the diocese. And we, you and I had this great opportunity to work with Bishop Murphy very closely and really appreciate also his wonderful ministry and his wonderful vision for the diocese on so many levels.
Oh, sure.
Including media and television.
Without a doubt, I know
and
that.
And liturgy and worship.
Yes, exactly. Although it's only been 60 years, the Diocese of Rockville Center has participated in many events that have brought the people of Long Island together through prayer, solidarity, and action. Whether it was familiarizing yourself with the new diocese, creating our television station, witnessing papal visits, or coming together after a tragedy, the unity of the faithful in our diocese has always aided in its growth and mission.
The 60th anniversary of the Diocese of Rockville Center is part of the dynamic and dramatic missionary history of the Catholic Church in the United States. One of the key dimensions of the inspirational story of the Diocese of Rockville Center is that whole post-World War II dynamic of the expansion of population on Long Island. So many wonderful families in the post-World War II era moving from Brooklyn and Queens, some from the Bronx, and their beautiful Catholic faith, the formation they received, being part of almost a pioneer movement to Long Island, establishing our these beautiful Catholic parishes, expanding what had been in place, and then also the whole Catholic school system in the Diocese of Rockville Center, how all of these families, despite limited means, despite moving from paycheck to paycheck and mortgage payments, they sacrificed deeply for our Catholic parishes and our Catholic schools. And as a result, generations have been formed beautifully in the Catholic faith and in this missionary spirit, which was there from the very beginning.
The biggest thing I remember about the early days of Rockville Center is I and my class, we were the last class ordained for the Diocese of Brooklyn. We were ordained in June of 1956. The diocese was officially established in Holy Thursday of 1957, and then in May, Bishop Kellenberg came to take position of diocese. I just think of all that was happening in the diocese at that time. We were finished with the Second World War, and Long Island had exploded as far as population went. I was reading recently that they were talking about the parish of St. William in Seaford, and they said that originally on the land where there were 100 farmers, by the late 1940s, there were 60,000 people. It just says something about the growth of Long Island. With the growth of Long Island, of course, came the growth of the church. And so, for example, in St. William's Parish, where there was one parish, then there were five.
I'm so delighted to be here to reflect on the 60 years of life here in the Diocese of Rockville Center. And as I look back, I remember having entered around that time and having been part of the growth of this diocese, the new parishes that were being formed, new ministries that were developing. And it doesn't seem like 60 years, but over that time, I've actually had the privilege of working with children in Blessed Sacrament School in Valley Stream, of working with priests in the Seminary of the Immaculate Conception.
In the early to mid-50s and certainly afterwards, many, many new parishes were established, both in Nassau and in Suffolk County, as communities grew literally overnight. Cardinal Cook invited Bishop McGann to be the host at the youth rally in Madison Square Garden. I think it's one of the only places in my life I lost emotion. You shouted, cried, screamed, and laughed all at the same time. Having it in Madison Square Garden was just an incredible thrill. Bishop Brennan, I believe, remembers being there as a teen, you know, and being part of that incredible experience.
I was in Madison Square Garden. He had been up in Boston, I think, on his first stop and made quite a hit, as he had since he was Pope. The garden was filled, and it was very, very a moving experience. And he was charismatic in coming in and going around the base, the floor of Madison Square Garden. And of course, young people are uninhibited, and they were whistling and screaming and doing all sorts of un-Pope things. And he seemed to thoroughly enjoy it.
Mother Teresa was invited to be here. She gave an extraordinary message, as are all of her messages extraordinary. But having Mother Teresa of Calcutta, the reality that a saint walked among us. How blessed we are on Long Island with so many saints, heroic men and women in all of our parishes. But indeed, here is a canonized saint walking among us, speaking to us. And what a great thrill that day was.
I was here when Mother Teresa came to visit our diocese, and she came and she appeared in our cathedral. And of course, here was this very, very small, this very tiny woman who had impressed the whole world and won a Nobel Prize for her wonderful work. And her talk was always very simple. It was always the same thing. You have in you the love of God. Share that love with others. Care for those who are poor. Care for those who are sick.
When we look back at the 60 years of our diocese, we know that we have been affected by many beautiful and challenging times. September 11th occurred when I was in my first year at the seminary. And I was asking God, what do you have in store for me? What am I being called to do? And we know that one of the great responsibilities of the priesthood is healing. And during September 11th, we saw so many priests, religious, reach out and be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ in the most devastating and trying time in our country, especially here in Rockville Center.
I was pastor in Baldwin on September 11th. There were five parishioners at St. Christopher's Parish who lost their lives. I learned later on when I went to Huntington that September 11th had many more casualties among St. Patrick's parishioners. At St. Patrick's, we have a plaque with the names of 32 parishioners who were lost that day. I'm not sure that they all lived in Huntington, but certainly they had family members who lived there. But the experience was devastating. About a week after September 11th, the firefighters in Nassau County, and I happened to be the chaplain of the Baldwin Fire Department at the time, they asked if they could have a memorial service for Nassau firefighters who were killed in 9/11 or city firefighters killed in 9/11 who lived in Nassau County. We were honored to host it at St. Christopher's Church. One of the fire chiefs said to me, "Do you think Bob Shepherd?" And Bob was the longtime Yankee announcer at Yankee Stadium. "Do you think Bob would read the names?" So I called Bob and he said, "John, I'd be honored."
During 9/11, which was such a powerful experience here on Long Island, and what I've heard about that mass at the Nassau Coliseum and the beautiful pastoral shepherding, that whole kind of sense of recognizing a incredible experience of the cross of Christ, and at the same time being able to move through that cross to the power of the resurrection and to the future.
As I look back over the last 16 years, there were so many things that happened, so many extraordinary moments that we shared together. But I don't think it would be fair for me to begin with anything else except what I've always called the greatest tragedy that we endured together, namely September 11th, 2001. The whole world crashed down around us as literally those two towers crashed down before our eyes. You didn't know what to do. What I think was the moment in which we as a diocese most came together was in about a month later, the Catholic tradition of a month's mind mass for those who have died. It's a beautiful tradition. And we got hold of Mr. Wong at the Coliseum, and we had a mass there. And the priests all came and celebrated with Bishop McGann and myself and the auxiliary bishops, Dunn and Sella. And the first responders, the police, the fire, the EMTs, they all came in their various their various uniforms. And the floor of the Colosseum, one side was all the priests and deacons. On the other side were all of those who were the first responders. And I stood on the podium there, on the platform there, and for 30 minutes people applauded those who had been so brave. That night I ended, the gospel we used was the gospel when Jesus washes the feet of his disciples. And I remember saying that the year after it was read, and I gave a little homily, a few thoughts. I said, I'd like to give that gospel to us for the rest of our lives. You and I have a task. No matter how horrid the tragedy of life is, no matter how many people suffer, we cannot just stand by and watch. We have to reach out. We have to wash one another's feet. And we have to be those who, like the first responders, continue to respond to those who suffer, those who have lost people whom they love, those who are in need in any way. I think that's probably the most important single thing that has marked our lives as a diocese in the last 16 years. But thank God the rest of it is not that way. And please God, it will never happen again.
One of the greatest times of my priesthood was most recently when Pope Francis came to visit us. We had the Mass at Madison Square Garden, and just the experience of walking in with the people of God, just it was like going to see a rock concert, and yet, what was it? The celebration of the Mass. Pope Francis, as always, was able to refocus us, not on the hymn, but the Jesus in him. And to look around that stadium that held concerts like Bruce Springsteen and the Rangers and the Knicks and all these other events, to know that what we were doing is the most sacred time of our faith journey, the celebration of the Eucharist. To look at the Vicar of Christ leading us as priests and the people of God in the hope of who we are as Catholics. Where? In MSG, in Madison Square Garden. We are thankful to Almighty God for that time, for being with him, and to celebrate that great mystery of our faith.
Pope Francis is a phenomenon. And when the word came out that he was coming here to the New York area, which we all knew as New Yorkers, of course he's going to come to New York. Who'd come to America without coming to New York? But I never thought that it would be such a joyful occasion as it turned out to be. He radiated an enthusiasm that just you could see in the faces of everyone. And the more he opened his heart to us, the more I saw the hearts of people being changed.
We talked about the 9/11 experience and the Mass together, but the diocese has known other big events as well, right? I mean, some very important ones. In this very cathedral, Mother Teresa spoke, way back, but in a very significant moment, addressing the entire diocese, right?
Jimmy, I always had this vision of the cathedral, you know, built out of the bricks. I don't know, but, you know, bricks always to me like a wonderful element of the cathedral's life. And, you know, I like this image of the bricks because, of course, to build a cathedral of this size, you know, you need to have a lot of bricks. And, you know, all of them are very important. All of them keep the structure. You know, all of them have this very crucial kind of a role in the whole building. And the same thing with all the events that we celebrated here. Yeah. You know, I call them a spiritual bricks, if you will. You know, we have these physical bricks that make the building. But you're right, spiritual, we also built another cathedral, a spiritual cathedral, if you will. And the events like this, especially Mother Teresa, you know, I was not here in the diocese yet when she was here, but I do remember vividly watching on television a wonderful speech she gave here in this cathedral with her beautiful voice and very, very thick accent, if you will. So that was sensitive to me because when I came to the diocese, I did struggle with her accent. And yet, even with the accent, and I have to tell you, at this point, she was really incredible inspiration to me, even with her accent and yet very simple English, the message that she was sharing with us was so powerful and so profound that I remember sitting really on the front of my TV set with my open mouth and it's like, wow, wow, wow. Said to myself, there is a hope for me. So I did really, really appreciate those wonderful events. But yes, definitely, those spiritual bricks make a wonderful mark in the history of our diocese and, of course, the history of this place.
Oh, sure. The other thing you mentioned was the television coverage, and that's one of the unique things about this diocese. There's only three, maybe four in the country of these dioceses or archdioceses that have their own television network or television studio, and we're able to really have a network here with Telecare, and what a great gift that has been to the diocese. I mean, I've been there for a dozen years now, but certainly my predecessor, Monsignor Tom Hartman, and the work that he did to establish this, along with Charles Dolan at Cablevision, and to have a 24-hour, seven-day-a-week
effort, right? And it's even wider, if you will. I have to tell you, I use the internet to watch our Telecare when I'm in Poland visiting my mother.
Wow, isn't that great?
It's incredible. Many, many times when I tell my mother about events going on in the diocese, so I tell her, you know, you can watch us. So she does watch our program coming to my sisters, and on internet they watch live.
Isn't
How incredible is that?
Yeah,
and even among my friends, you know, when I tell them about things going on in our diocese, I encourage them to go to the, you know, monitors, to the computer screens, and watch our television live.
Sure.
And I have to tell you, it is incredible. I do remember being on vacation so many, many times, and even worldwide events, like I do remember watching a Eucharistic Congress in Canada, you know, in Poland, through the internet, and I watch our television network. So I think it's growing and wider and wider and wider, of course, through the media and through satellite connections and through internet, I think it's really fascinating how widely this television network can go, and how many wonderful means of social media we can use right now to spread the good news.
And it's so unique, really, in so many ways. What a great tool of evangelization, right? Just a great tool.
It is. Great tool, and it's really helping us to make, you know, our voice louder. You know, I have this great image, a great image of a preacher, for example. Think about it. The preacher can come to the cathedral, and you know, even if he had nice things to say, you know, only a few people in the front row can hear him. But when you have the microphone, a wonderful microphone, giving you a great sound, like the cathedral does.
Sure.
The rest of the congregation can hear you. You know, 1,000 people, 1,500 people. And I think that's exactly what is the rule of the social media or even network or television, you know,
sure.
Magnifies the voice or spreads out, make it wider, make it further, and reaches out more hearts and more people. And what a great means, and as you said, tool of communication and evangelization.
A great
very
blessing.
Much needed.
Yeah, that's for sure. Well, we're going to take a quick break. Stay tuned as we celebrate the 60th anniversary of the Diocese of Rockville Center. Welcome back to Celebrating 60 Years of the Diocese of Rockville Center. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaun, joined by my co-host, Bishop Andrzej Szaslewski. Catholic Health Services of Long Island is an integrated health care delivery system with some of the region's finest health and human service agencies. Under the sponsorship of the Diocese of Rockville Center, CHS serves hundreds of thousands of Long Islanders each year, providing care that extends from the beginning of life to helping people live their lives in the final years with comfort, grace, and dignity. As a ministry of the Catholic Church, CHS continues Christ's healing mission, promotes excellence in care, and commits itself to those in need.
As I survey the history of our Catholic health care in the Diocese of Rockville Center, it is not only inspirational, it's somewhat miraculous. And to see generations of doctors, of health care leaders, of nurses, of hospital staff, aligned around the splendor of truth of our Catholic moral teaching, our belief in the sanctity of human life at every stage of life, our belief in the dignity of the human person, our preferential option for the poor and how that plays out in a healthcare system, our beautiful sensitivity and reverence for refugee and immigrant families. It's something that is part of dramatic missionary growth. I think it's so important for our younger generations to understand exactly what the Catholic Church has brought to healthcare, not only in history, but in the present. I think it's a way to inspire our young people to really appreciate the powerful mission of the Catholic Church on earth, a mission of humility, a mission of mercy, and a mission that is really kind of game-changing, not only in church history, but in world history.
I've had the chance to work with some of our Catholic hospitals since about 2002. By that point, they had already joined together in a system. You know, we have a very, very rich tradition throughout Catholic hospitals. First of all, we have to give an awful lot of credit to the religious congregations of women who founded those hospitals. I was recently at a gathering for St. Charles Hospital, and they showed some old photos and old film footage and of the sisters working with young children, and you could just see the joy in the young children who were experiencing tremendous illness and difficulties, and you realize how important that work was.
Bishop McGann was a visionary in so many ways, and one of the ways he showed that vision was as he recognized that there was a changing times. And so in the late 1900s, he was the one who took all of our hospitals, at that time four, we're now six, and brought them together and took over the responsibility that so that those hospitals could continue to grow and flourish. Because as times change and people have changed, we had a situation in which we needed to have lay people come in to pick up the ball from where the sisters were not able to do it by themselves all alone. Catholic Health Services in Long Island now is a multi-billion dollar apostolic mission. We see this as an extension of the ministry of Jesus Christ for the people of God who are sick, no matter who they are. Because we don't make any distinctions in who comes to our hospitals. We do it not because they're Catholics, but because we're Catholics, and we have a ministry and a commitment that we have to fulfill, a responsibility before God to use the talents of people, bring them together. And with that vision, that holistic vision of the human person created in God's image, to take those who are sick and make them healthy, to take those who are suffering and give them, take away their pain, to make those who are in need in any way who can benefit from us, the beneficiaries of Catholic healthcare. It is an extraordinary gift and mission.
The diocese offers us school for our youth. The diocese has hospital and nursing homes to take care of the sick.
In the late 90s, just before 2000, Bishop McGann and the people working with him pulled together the system, which is now known as CHS, and we've grown stronger since. And that too was an act of great courage, tremendous sacrifice.
Catholic Health Services was formed in October of 1997 by Bishop John McGann because he and others had concluded that with changes in hospital reimbursement, community hospitals couldn't survive on their own.
The whole reason we're in healthcare is to promote the dignity of the human person, to serve the sick in the ways that Jesus did, and it's such an incredible mission, Catholic healthcare. But then, I think by being true to who we are, I think that's been sort of the key to some of the success of the system.
We are part of the mission of the Catholic Church. There's a special spirit of caring in our hospitals. We have one standard of care without regard to race, creed, ethnic origin, or ability to pay. The staffs of our hospitals and nursing homes and the home nursing service and hospice take the church's mission in healthcare seriously. We're here for a reason, and that is to continue Christ's healing mission here on earth.
Great piece about CHS, and I've been involved on the board for many years. You've been involved with CHS for many years. Right. What a tremendous gift that is to the diocese as well, a unique gift to the diocese, don't you think?
Certainly is, Jim. I think that Second Vatican Council changed the focus, if you will, on medical care, and especially on the importance of people who need a medical assistance, those who are challenged with medical issues, those who suffer, even those who are dying. It was during the Vatican Second Council when we discovered what incredible power, spiritual power, these people have in the life of the church. Mm-hmm. So you cannot think of them as a kind of, you know, people on the borders of, if you will, second-class citizens in the life of the church. The spiritual energy they provide, connecting the suffering and obstacles and challenges of life with the suffering of Christ, who continues to suffer through us. Yeah. You know, think about this. Yeah. You know, they are, these people are the people who carry the cross together with Jesus, cross that produces grace and salvation and redemption. So these people are grace providers. So I think, you know, the CHS, that really makes a wonderful network, you know, and helps them to carry this cross with dignity. And even a CHS in cooperation, of course, with Telecare, bringing the spiritual meaning, you know, to all these challenges that they have in life, through their suffering. You know, I have to tell you, maybe as we look back at the history of our diocese, and we are so grateful so for so many wonderful things that we have, it is because of the great ministry that sick and dying are doing for the well-being of all of us here on Long Island. So I think it's incredible.
I always tell people when I'm explaining CHS, I say, you know, when you go to buy a new car, you don't say, I just want four tires. I mean, they all have four tires. Like, hospitals all make people well, but it's the Catholic context of being sick and knowing redemptive suffering that changes everything. And for me, that's the choice for CHS.
Absolutely, Jim. I think that, you know, what is so incredible about the spiritual, or if you will, a Christian dimension of suffering, you know, it is already eschatological. You know, which means, you know, we have already a someone who gave us a direction, who through this eschatological dimension, you know, gives us hope and gives us faith. And most of all, the whole big idea of redemptive suffering, if you will, you
so
know,
what you do
in your suffering, you know, you create this a spiritual credit. I call them a spiritual money that you can disperse, you know, for the really well-being of your loved ones or many things and issues going on in the church. Think about St. Teresa, little flower, you know, how come this little girl who was never ever in any missionary country, it's also a patron of the missionary work of the church.
Yeah.
Just because she was able to translate, you know, all her little obstacle, her little challenges for the missionary work of the church, you know.
Yeah.
This is the kind of power, you know, people do have. And I think for us, even providing or helping them with seeing this in eschatological perspective, that's really this incredible work for all the faithful in our diocese.
In his apostolic exhortation, Joy of the Gospel, Pope Francis says evangelization is the task of the church. The church as the agent of evangelization is more than an organic and hierarchical institution. She is first and foremost a people advancing on its pilgrim way towards God. Through its many unique and vibrant ministries, the Diocese of Rockville Center enriches the faith, serves those in need, and fosters stewardship.
The importance of education is all-encompassing. It looks at the life of young people. It guides them through life, not only academically, but in their faith, which is really what the life of the church is about. And it gives opportunity to our young people to grow in their faith and be the future leaders of the church. They are the ones who are going to fill the pews in the future. So it's a wonderful investment. It's certainly a valuable investment for our society, but more importantly for our church. Because without the young people and without their knowledge of the faith and their practice of the faith, we have no future in the church, and that can't happen.
One of my responsibilities as a priest was to be assigned at Holy Trinity High School to see really the development, the seedbed of the future of our church, to look at our young people with coming in as freshmen with their hearts open to what God had in store for them. Very often I would kid around with the teachers and say, you may be responsible for having them pass the Regents, but I have to get them into heaven. And how awesome that was to be in that journey with those young people, opening their hearts to learn and knowledge, but also to recognize that they are beloved daughters and sons of God. And that's what Catholic education is all about here in the Diocese of Rockville Center, to assure these young people and their parents that they're coming forth to know and meet the Lord, and to learn things like history and math and all those others, but to most importantly know that they are beloved children of God.
Catholic education is a major blessing to us here in Rockville Center. And I have been blessed to serve in our high schools here on the island, and I have been blessed to watch young people who we are given the privilege of working with them and their parents at continuing the important task of educating our young people to be people of faith, to be people of prayer, to be people of service.
Catholic schools and technology really go hand in hand because it's a learning process, it's a tool, it's an instrument for our students because they have to have their finger on the pulse of education just like all of the students in all the school systems. But it's really very much integrated. We are with Chromebooks, we have iPads, we have all of the up-and-coming technologies, we're constantly learning. Just to highlight that, we had our first diocesan STEM fair this year, which promoted technology and science and math and all of the current things that are really going to propel our young people and will provide them with their ability to contribute to society and provide them being confident and independent leaders of the world.
Catholic education has a history, if you will, of serving the poor, the immigrant, the people who may not have opportunities that are given to everybody else. And so we're working very hard to make sure that we're reaching out to newer communities to welcome people in and have people experience the richness of the opportunities that comes in Catholic education. And then there's one other that's incredibly, incredibly important, and this goes to the heart of everybody, no matter where you are on the socioeconomic or scale. Catholic education, in the end, builds up, forms a core of committed people. All right, sure, we're going to have committed people from all walks of life, from all kinds of education, but the statistics show that I wish everybody who went to Catholic schools also went to Mass and practiced their faith, but honestly, statistically, it's our best shot.
We need to celebrate our faith, and our young and young adults need to live it through how they are in their daily lives. It's not just a matter of being reading scripture, it's making scripture real to them.
The future of Catholic education, I believe, is gaining momentum slowly, but certainly in a strong manner. People want quick answers, they want things to pop up, they want it to be strong and vibrant overnight. That's not going to happen. That's not the way the world is today. But I do believe that Catholic education will gain momentum and go little by little, slowly by slowly. And I think in doing it in that manner, we're going to gain sustainability, we're going to gain viability, and we're going to be stronger. We're built on the shoulders of those before us, but we can't give up that mission. We can't give up that legacy. So I think as we reflect and where do we gain our strength for the future? The future has a lot of questions in it. The future is very challenging. But if we reflect on the back and the legacy of Catholic education, we have a strength, we have a foundation, we have a bedrock on which to build. So in forging ahead, it's always been my goal to give to the people who are the leaders, to our teachers, our principals, our administrators, the confidence and the pride in what we do. It's a gift, it's a mission, it's a vocation. And as long as we keep that at heart, I can't see anything but good happening to our schools.
The Office of New Evangelization, which was created in 2005 to bring together ministries that are active, that connect directly with the people, continue to serve and respond to the call of St. John Paul II to go out and announce how we live our faith.
The diocese has outreach program to take care of people. The diocese has a new evangelization program where each and everyone can hear the word of God in its own language according to its according to his or her own culture. So really we have every reason to be thankful to God and to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the diocese.
Having the opportunity and being blessed by Bishop Murphy to serve as Secretary for New Evangelization, I had the blessing of working with so many different ministries within the diocese to see that all the diocese does for all the multicultural groups in our diocese, to work with the youth, young adult, and campus ministries, and to see the tremendous growth that has taken place in that area. The young people in our Newman clubs and in the many things that occur for our young adults have reached out in so many various ways through service and prayer and their own personal discernment. These are all wonderful graces and blessings for the diocese.
Ethnic ministries, that's all of us. That's simply all of us. It's our church. But in Long Island, in our Diocese of Rockville Center, to give you an example, the Office of Hispanic Ministry serves 54 parishes with active Hispanic ministry. Out of the 132 parishes here, 54 have active Hispanic ministry. That means that they celebrate the sacraments in Spanish, that they have different movements in Spanish active in the parish, and that there's really a real active presence of the Hispanic people in the parishes. But it's not just Hispanic. We have the Polish, we have the Koreans, we have the Haitians, we have the Italians, the Filipino community. We have many parishes that celebrate in their own language and celebrate their culture.
Since I came to this diocese, the main things that have always touched my heart is how the diocese, through the Haitian American Apostolate Ministry, has embraced the Haitian folks. I have always been touched to see how the diocese celebrate with us our Independence Day on January 1st. How the diocese celebrate with us our Flag Day on May 18th. How the diocese in time of trials, the diocese stands with us. The earthquake, the diocese was there to pray with us. The hurricane, the diocese was there to pray with us. Whenever there was need, whether spiritual or financial, the diocese has always been there with us.
It's really a wonderful disposition and goal that the diocese has to be for all people and to include all people.
I find it inspirational to see, with our beautifully diverse Hispanic population, how our Catholic priests are able to understand and to delve into the history of a parishioner who's from El Salvador, Ecuador, and how they're able to, both linguistically and culturally, in their own way, with their own charism and personality, able to be a bridge of the divine mercy and to inspire the people they serve.
So we have 16,000 students in 47 Catholic elementary schools. It's an incredible, incredible amount of young people.
It is beautiful, and what a variety. And even now, look at this, as even now we are even looking for the possibility of opening the doors of our schools to a Hispanic community.
Yes, yeah.
You know, a Hispanic community and even other nations. Immigrants come here and sometimes they come here with a notion or leave in our diocese without even thinking that they can afford a Catholic education. So our new initiative, I think, is also opening a new chapter in the life of our diocese when we really throw out this great possibility for a Catholic education and widely open to our immigrants. And I think it's very, very crucial and very, very important.
And our high schools, too, now have become vibrant places of faith formation and even a place that fosters vocations now, right?
And what a great preparation for college studies. You know, we do have incredible high schools. You know, I remember even talking to a few parents. You know, some of them even intentionally do not send kids to elementary school, Catholic elementary school, to save the money for high school, Catholic high school, in preparation for the college studies. Yeah, you know, that really says something incredible about the quality of our education in our high school.
I was thinking, too, the days when we were in the seminary, when we were studying, something in Huntington, at the seminary in Huntington, miraculous kind of happened. And one year, lay people began to study with us. And they were studying in the classrooms with us. And so what happened was we were studying with people who were doing as much work as we were. And this incredible gift of faith formation was kind of blossoming before our very eyes, which continues to this very day as well, right?
Oh, Jim, I agree with you. I do remember even interaction and exchanges with those lay students, you know, in our classrooms. And I do smile many, many times because they were for us, as you remember, like a really grand check.
Oh, sure.
You know, it is very easy for us to have this very lofty, beautiful, spiritual thoughts, how we are going to carry the message of Jesus. You know, these people in our conversation and classroom discussions, you know, kept us really grounded. You know,
they
really
they
told us straight into our face what's going to work, what is not going to work, what they are buying, what they are not buying. And I think that was incredible and a very healthy exchange. And I definitely hope that this kind of dialogue is going to continue to keep us grounded.
And we've seen so many beautiful and wonderful experiences of lay leadership in our diocese over the last 60 years, right?
Exactly.
Catechetical leaders and all kinds of
and
things.
And this master program in our seminary, but also Pastoral Formation Institute, you know, as you know, as our Faith Formation Office also gets involved with this kind of higher education, preparing a leadership in our parishes to take that leading role. Yeah. So in so many ways, I'm so glad, because think about this, we all come from the same building, from the same school, we take the same kind of classes, so we are kind of one mind and one heart, if you
it's
will.
True. Yeah, it's true.
Right? Being all together, shoulder to shoulder, hand to hand, and leading all our faithful in this wonderful pilgrimage journey to God's kingdom.
Yeah, it's so true. Now, were you involved in new evangelization for a while when this office was formed in the Diocese of Rockville Center?
No, I was not. But, however, maybe partially, if you will, by doing work already in the Office of Worship, you know, which is very, very beautiful, I have to tell you. And I'm glad that Bishop Barres also emphasized on the fact that, you know, it would be impossible for us to reach the goals of new evangelization without having this Eucharistic, if you will, or spiritual perspective.
Right. Right.
If we are not going to really focus ourselves on the Eucharist being the summit and source of all the church's activities, of all the ecclesial ministries, you know, we are going to miss something. We are really not going to go in the right direction. See that. So my work with the Office of Worship somehow, you know, tied me with new evangelization, and I was so glad that this boat, if you will, wings, as Holy Father Francis so beautifully reminds us, you know, we have to use two wings to fly. So I think that our evangelical, or if you will, educational perspective and liturgical perspective kind of fly together.
Help us to go.
It's wonderful, yeah.
So important. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back with more right after this. Welcome back to Celebrating 60 Years of the Diocese of Rockville Center. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlohan, joined by my co-host, Bishop Andrzej Szaslewski, who's an auxiliary bishop of the diocese. We've been talking about some of the great ministries of the diocese, and where would we be without Catholic Charities? Catholic Charities of the Diocese of Rockville Center began providing care with dignity, life with hope, in 1957, shortly after the creation of the diocese. Today, it's one of the major service providers of Long Island, serving the basic needs of the poor, the troubled, the weak, and the oppressed, and is committed to addressing the causes of injustice.
This year, we're celebrating 60 years, and we're very excited about that. And we're doubly excited because we're also commemorating 100 years of Catholic Charities in New York State. So a lot of people aren't aware that Catholic Charities was established in New York State by an act of the legislature that took place in 1917. And so together we are commemorating 100 years. So I like to say that we are going to do more partying than the rest of the dioceses in New York State, because we get to celebrate both 60 years and 100 years.
One of the things that strikes me is the great work of Catholic Charities here in the diocese. Wonderful work. Monsignor Charlie Birmingham was the first director of Charities, and it meant building, you know. And the model was, you know, to set up offices around the diocese. But, you know, within a couple of years, something else transpired out of the inspiration of one priest. And that was the concept of concrete services close to where the people were in need.
Most of the people who come to Catholic Charities, in addition to whatever their concrete need might be, for food, for clothing, for mental health services, is that they suffer from not feeling a sense of self-worth, a sense of self-esteem, because of the problems in their life. And so the first and most important thing that our staff does is to give them that sense of welcome and that sense of value, that they're worth our time, they're worth our effort, and to treat them with dignity. Of course, the motto of the agency, care with dignity and life with hope. And so that's the first and most important thing that we do.
Right now, here at 60 years in our diocese, you know, we're coming together again, parishes, Catholic Charities, diocesan offices, to try to figure out how we work with the public sector and with other faith communities, as well as the educational system, to be there as never before to help people who are dealing with this struggle, and in particular, to be there for young people who are trying, as all young people do, to find their identity and figure out who they are.
Catholic Charities has a rich tradition in our diocese, serving the poor at so many levels. Again, people are tremendously, tremendously generous, and they look for opportunities. People want to be able to make sure that their generosity really helps people, and Catholic Charities provides that for us. So reaching out to the poor, helping parishes through parish social ministry, parish outreach to help those who are in need. We all need a little bit of help and encouragement along the way, and we're all in a position to be able to offer that help and encouragement. So thanks to Catholic Charities for the tremendous work they do.
The growth of the diocese over the 60 years has been great, because in addition to the growth of Catholic Charities, there have been the growth of so many other great groups, associations, and institutions. Obviously, Catholic Education, and we really benefit from partnering with them in terms of volunteer projects. The tremendous growth in parish social ministry throughout the diocese, that there is a local social justice presence that works with Catholic Charities to meet concrete needs in the community.
I think back on 9/11 and the heartache of so many families here in our diocese, and Catholic Charities was able to step up and reach out to families who presented a different kind of need than we typically saw as Catholic Charities. Many of the families impacted were families who wouldn't otherwise have come to Catholic Charities. In fact, they were families who came to Catholic Charities to offer goods and support to help struggling neighbors. And yet these were the families who needed our support after 9/11. So we were able, again, to work with parishes, mobilize communities, create support groups that were so critical for people, and to be there in the initial days with tangible assistance. Some families who lost the sole breadwinner were in a position where they didn't know how they were going to pay their mortgage for the next couple of months. And so to be there in very tangible ways, as well as to just walk the journey.
I think the challenges for the future are to be able to go deeper into the spiritual dimension of service. To, as Jesus would welcome people and meet their concrete need, he would always then challenge them spiritually as well, because of course he knew, and we know, that people's spiritual needs often accompany their physical needs. And so as Charities, to continue to work on integrating more and more spirituality into the work that we do, because it offers such a great support, a great reassurance, and a great guidance for people who have special problems and obstacles and challenges in their life.
The ministries of Catholic Charities have evolved over 60 years. So we have, for example, now significant senior services, and that corresponds with the emerging demographic on Long Island. We know that people talk about the aging demographic and how that's been growing. And so again, for Catholic Charities to be there for our seniors, who many of whom are homebound, to be able to be there with Meals on Wheels, with case management services, and for those seniors who are still able to get out and about, to come to the senior centers where we see them engage so beautifully and connect with one another, share their stories of their families and the celebrations and the heartaches of life, and to not be alone.
I don't think there's a priest or bishop in this diocese that hasn't needed Catholic Charities to help them in some way in their priestly ministry with people that we meet. What an important ministry, right?
Oh, absolutely, Jim. You know, I think that, you know, this is evangelization in action.
Yeah.
This is actually the love of the Lord in action. This is the presence of Christ in the community in action, you know, and I would call this Catholic Charities, you know, reaching out to those, you know, underprivileged. I remember it was during my studies when I heard this incredible African proverb, which I have to tell you, it touched my heart and still stays with me, and more every year I realize how important that is. To heaven, we never go alone. To heaven, we go together.
Wow.
So it doesn't really matter, you know, how advanced you are or how developed you are, if you will, intellectually or materially.
Sure.
Let's don't forget that to heaven we never go alone. We go together.
And it's really much like the letter of James, right? What good is it to have faith?
That's right.
If you don't have the works. And this is the work of the church. And so many volunteers with Catholic Charities, thousands of them across our own diocese, who give their time to reach out to those in need, to feed the poor, to be with people who are having children who have no place to go, but they've chosen life. All of those moments are such an important component of what we do every day, right?
Jim, absolutely. I think that, you know, our faith is not really about how and what we pray. It's not all about words. Yeah. And think about this, each time when we come to the church and we say our prayers, we finish them with the word amen, which means, yes, Lord, we will do this, you know, that's going to happen. You know, and let's face it, how many amens we say even during the Mass in the prayer. But you know what, our faith is not really about the words, it's not about the promises that we make. Faith show itself in deeds.
Right.
You know,
right.
Faith, believe it or not, is an action, you know, and Catholic Charities, you know, really help us to implement this action into this worldly faith and prayers that we may sometimes have. So I think it's a wonderful opportunity and a wonderful channel for us to put our faith in practice.
Yeah, without a doubt. As we commemorate the 60th anniversary, where would we be without our diocesan priests? These are the men that are a part of the life of the church. They've touched us all in very many ways, and they're there for us in the biggest joys of our life, also in those times of tremendous hardship and sorrow. As Pope St. John Paul II once said, the priestly vocation is a gift from God, but it's also a gift to the church.
In celebrating the 60 years anniversary of our diocese, we're just so grateful that the Lord of the Harvest has blessed us with so many amazing priests and religious. In a particular way, for this time, I've been entrusted as the vocation director. We know that vocations do not fall out of the sky. They come from dedicated families, teachers, priests, and communities. We all have a co-responsibility in assisting and promoting vocations for our current church and for the future. We pray in a particular way in thanksgiving that the Lord will bless us with many, many more years of dedicated priests and religious to serve our diocese.
When we speak about vocations, it's important that we have a culture of vocations. You know, we can't just complain that we don't have vocations. We must be proactive and do something about it. I'd often say to the students, do you want your children and your grandchildren to have religious and priests in their lives? And of course they say yes. And then I said, where do you expect them to come from? They're not on the shelves in Target. We can't make copies of them. So we need to invite others constantly to consider following Jesus in a particular religious community or as a diocesan priest by serving God's people here on Long Island.
After a few years, the seminary opened up to lay people studying in the seminary. One of the things that the Vatican Council had done was to really say that laity have a role in the church. And the role in the church is not just because there aren't enough priests or religious to do it. Their role in the church is part of what they are as baptized people who are part of the church. So all the ideas were beginning to spread of people getting better educated in their faith, people teaching in their faith, people entering into all kinds of ministries. In our diocese, we started off with a pastoral formation institute, which became a great place where people could go after work and spend whatever number of hours for a class to get credits, to learn about their faith and then to teach it. I taught in pastoral formation so many, many times. I was so impressed by lay people who would work all day, run home and get a quick supper, and come out at night and sit in a class for 2 hours and do the reading and do the studying and be enthused about it and interested in it. It was a great time.
When you look back, it's hard to believe how at this point we have, I think it's 1.6 million Catholics here in the Diocese of Rockville Center. And also as I look back, you know, it's very different. When I was in Blessed Sacrament, there were 12 sisters in that school. And we also ran religious ed in the afternoons. Now we're down to 47 schools, and there are very few religious in those schools. So now our lay women and lay men are taking the place of religious brothers and sisters in preparing our youth, our teens, young adults, and of course, all of our adults here in the diocese to help them to grow in their understanding of themselves as real missionaries.
I worked for a few years after being in the parish with a great priest, Father Fred Schaefer, and we were in religious education work together. And his insights about the place of the laity and carving out the place of the laity, not just saying you've got a job to do, but let us help you to provide the training that you'll need.
Bishop Barris has said that he would like to increase the vocations in the seminary, and he's got a great focus on young people. So that makes me feel good. This thrust towards reaching out to young people, letting them know who we are as a church, just as a church first, and then letting them know that this is a viable possibility for their lives in the future. As we look on some of the history of the great priests, the priests that we know well in the history of the Diocese of Rockville Center, the history of priests that might be not as well known. We draw inspiration from them, and we ask for not only dramatic missionary growth for the church on Long Island, but it's the connection between dramatic missionary growth and dramatic growth in vocations to the priesthood and religious life.
I've been a priest for 1 year, and so there is so much to grow. I see the priests around me, and every day it's an opportunity to grow in the simple things, you know, like the celebration of the sacraments, the encounter with the people. So I would like myself to have clear, you know, in that growth in all my journey, you know, as at all levels, my faith, my inculturization also.
As a deacon, I would like to say I have never regretted being a deacon, and I have been enjoying every single moment of it. I have been able to share actively in the life of the church and being able to serve the people of God in a special way through the diaconate.
One of the other ways I was blessed here in the Diocese of Rockville Center was by working in vocation and formation throughout my years here. As vocation director for the Franciscan Brothers, I interacted and worked on teams with diocesan priests and seminarians, sisters and brothers from other congregations, in trying to continue to educate the people of our diocese of the importance of working in religious education, in Catholic schools, in so many different areas and venues in our parishes, to promote and to educate people of the importance of vocation.
This year we're preparing for another great class of deacons to be ordained. And looking back over the service and having lived, you know, with men and worked with men in parishes, St. Killian's, where I'm living now, how very, very good that these persons have shown themselves to be. People of faith, people who love the church, people who minister the word of God so effectively.
Throughout the years of this diocese, we have watched groups of religious sisters, brothers, and priests engaged in just about every type of ministry, from education to nursing to many beginning of new ministries. As a matter of fact, there were religious involved in the beginning of telecare. So all throughout the life of our church here, our religious have been very, very important. Besides that, we are blessed with a powerhouse of prayer. We have so many of our senior religious, our elderly religious, who are currently living in their mother houses, and they spend their time working and praying for the diocese, for all the good works of our religious communities and all that happens. Each of us, in following the charism and the mission and the values of our founders and foundresses, reach out to the people of Long Island in this diocese to share the great love that we have in following Jesus Christ, in being able to serve you. We have done this in the past 60 years and hope to continue many years into the future.
It's an exciting time for the priesthood on Long Island. It's really critical that all of us here sacrifice each and every day, carry crosses each and every day, pray each and every day for a dramatic increase in vocation to the priesthood and religious life, and for a dramatic sort of depth of holiness of priests in the Diocese of Rockville Center and of priests around the world.
Bishop Andre, we spoke earlier about the importance of this place for us, because just a few feet from here, you and I were both ordained priests. You were ordained a bishop here. This is an important place for the priests of the Diocese of Rockville Center. And we think back, not just the ones who are living, but all those who have gone before us, the tremendous influence they've all had, part of those spiritual bricks you were talking about, really, that have built this church on Long Island, huh?
Absolutely, and Jim, maybe a little piece of my personal story. I came to this diocese in 1988, and I have to tell you, I came to visit New York with no English, and mind you to say, I came only for my Christmas vacation.
Wow.
I'm still here. And I will tell you why, because already my first weeks or first days, you know, I met incredible priests of our diocese, starting with Bishop Markiewicz, who is in so many ways, you know, responsible for me being in the diocese. I will never forget my first visit to the rectory here in the Diocese of Rockville Center. It was a Blessed Sacrament in Valley Stream. I do remember then Monsignor John Don was a pastor there, later our bishop, Monsignor Morrissey was there, Father Joe Miro was there. I remember being them at the table. At this point, I was just smiling because I didn't speak any English.
Wow.
But already then, I do remember how very much influenced I was by the spirit of fraternity, the quality of priesthood, that really made me to realize, you know what, I love this church. I love these people. I wanted to be with them. I want to grow up with them. Wow. I want to spend the rest of my life with them. I want to serve them. 28 years later, I'm still here, as you can see, and that was just because of that. You know, really, my priesthood will be like, as every priesthood should be, falling in love.
Sure.
With this church, falling in love with the priesthood and the quality of priesthood of this diocese. Listen, maybe not always perfect, but you know, we are all human. But I think incredible thing about America, I have to tell you, I discovered, we always find a way to recover. You know, we evaluate ourselves. You know, we have to admit our faults.
Sure.
We have to face and challenge our weaknesses. But you know, let's don't forget that we are here in this beautiful cathedral, not because we are perfect.
Right.
We are priests not because we are perfect, because we are forgiven. You know, we are the church of really forgiving grace that helps us to be lifted up and stand up, you know, and help people to stand up. And let's walk in faith, you know, with dignity of our human life. And I have to tell you, when I saw this great potential and seeing this really wonderful American church or here in the Diocese of Rockville Center, always evolving, always looking for the best, that's a love affair.
Incredible gift, right?
That's a love affair.
I know for me, too, I credit so much the religious women of this diocese, even with my own personal vocation, the Sisters of St. Joseph, the Sisters of St. Dominic, and their prophetic presence in this diocese that has begun hospitals, that has begun schools, that has taught communities how to pray. They've been a tremendous witness, too, over these 60 years, don't you think?
Yeah, and that was, I have to tell you, a great, nice eye-opening for me coming from Poland, not seeing so many really lay women or even religious, you know, involved in formation or involved in the life of the church. Even then seeing, you know, a laity so wonderfully involved with Eucharistic ministry, I have to tell you, was a really very, very positive and very strong experience in my life. And I remember already from the beginning having this a wonderful sense of great potential, you know, great potential that I want to be the part of. And I have to tell you, I still see this potential growing, beautifully evolving, and I'm really excited about next decades, you know, in the life of our diocese. It is really very promising.
We're going to take a quick break. When we get back, we're going to talk a little bit about the future, so stick around. Right. Welcome back to Celebrating 60 Years of the Diocese of Rockville Center. Any kind of anniversary like this, as you were saying at the beginning, Bishop, pushes us to the future. We have to look to the future, and there's wonderful things coming, don't you think, in our diocese?
Oh, I do. I can even, Jim, share with you maybe a little bit from my background and from my ministry in our diocese. Look at this, as much as we have done already with liturgical reform, you know, many people will agree that, you know, maybe not everything in this liturgical reform like went kind of well. So as we celebrate this anniversary and as we just introduce also a third edition of the Roman Missal, it was a great time for us to evaluate. Listen, we have done so much and we have achieved so much, even in our worship or Eucharistic celebration. But you know what? We can still do better. We can still do more. And I think to me it's exactly that key or excitement toward the future, you know. And Bishop Barres has this already a great vision of using the media, using you know, social media,
sure,
especially on spreading the good news or even doing a liturgical catechesis. You know, I really see the future of us improving even our liturgical celebration and this way improving our faith. And because of improved faith, we can improve our lives.
And it becomes a circle.
Precisely.
Right? And that's the beautiful
and
gift.
That is the future, yeah.
And that's really what we try to do at Telecare every day as we continue to grow and hopefully connect the dots in the future too, right across the country.
Oh, you know? You are the media of all media.
That's what we're hoping.
You guys are very large and wonderful. And I think I see exactly Telecare and what you do here at Telecare being this a wonderful umbrella for all our you know, media resources, which we can absolutely utilize and even put them together into this, you know, I call this, let's put it this way, a symphony, you know.
Yeah, it's true.
Let's say our iPhones, our cell phones, our smartphones, our internet could be a little bit instrument of this larger orchestra. And, you know, to me, you are the very big piece of conducting this orchestra. So I hope that this is exactly going to be our step toward the future.
Big blessing. The past 60 years of the diocese has been an amazing time. And as we look forward to the future, let's hear now from Bishop John Barres and some of our newly ordained priests.
Part of the reason for celebrating our 60th anniversary is to not only take inspiration from the past, the sacrifices, the spirit of ecclesial courage and innovation, and the willingness to meet the historical crises of a certain moment of time in the church with great holiness and mission, is not only to go into the past to draw inspiration, but to take that inspiration into the current context. We have all sorts of changes. We have all sorts of challenges, which if we let timidity and fear take us over, we could just roll over and let things play out. But that's not the Catholic spirit. That's not the spirit of our Catholic mystics, our Catholic saints, our Catholic game changers, if you will. Each one of us, as we celebrate the 60th anniversary, are called to follow the logic of our baptism, called to open our lives to the purifying fire of the Holy Spirit, driving us on new mission, having a deep confidence that dramatic missionary growth is the future of the church on Long Island, and that each one of us has a part to play in a spirit of communion and mission.
I have hope that more people will return to church. Now, I know we all hope that. The reason I feel hopeful about it is that just in this short time of being a priest, I've met so many people who are on the brink of coming back or have come back or who are not back at all, but I meet them at certain functions and get a chance to talk to them. And I see that people are looking for God. They're looking for relationships. They're looking for something more than what they're getting in their everyday lives. So I feel hopeful because I see people searching. I see people searching for a relationship with Christ, with God. Sometimes they can't define it, but in our conversations, I think there's a hunger there. One of my hopes is that we will be able to let people know that the church is a place where they can look for and find a relationship with God.
The future, you know, for the diocese holds, you know, so many good things. And as the diocese, we are doing God's work. And God, you know, never does any mistakes. So I know that faith continue growth, you know, in Long Island. You know, we see the churches, you know, being, you know, filled with the spirit of Pope Francis, you know, and all in the priesthood, in the communities. So it's so much going on right now, you know, and even our presence, you know, as faith, you know, the Catholic Church, it's very alive.
As we celebrate the 60 years of our diocese, you know, we need to congratulate each other. Really, congratulate each other and continue to celebrate our faith as we continue to share the faith. Again, by how we serve, by how we look and care for our brothers and sisters.
One of the great things about celebrating an anniversary is that looking back, it gives us an opportunity, really, very importantly, to look forward, to remember who we are, what we're about, and to move forward. With the arrival of Bishop Barris, he brings a new excitement to us, a new opportunity. His motto, Holiness and Mission, reminds us of who we are, and his constant mantra, Dramatic Missionary Growth, just inspires us in so many ways. I can see us growing in leaps and bounds by proclaiming Jesus boldly and unapologetically. You know, he's going to use all of the new tools that are out there. He's out there visiting people. He's of great use with telecare and social media. That's going to be important to him, and it's exciting to be a part of that.
I want to thank each and every one of you for the beautiful way you've been part of the 60-year history of the Mission of Mercy of the Catholic Diocese of Rockville Center. It's a time for us to remember the souls of our family members who have gone before us, who have been part of this mission, the souls of the priests and women and men religious who have been so inspirational. And it's a time for all of us to allow the Holy Spirit to take us deeper in a spirit of holiness and mission so that you and I can be instruments of dramatic missionary growth on Long Island. God bless you all.
He said it again, their dramatic missionary growth. We've heard that from him many times. That's the mantra of our growth, huh?
Jimmy, it is, and I think it's incredible, but please forgive me if I'm going to bring us back to our, do you remember our belonging more deeply?
Yes, of course.
You sure. Know, I call Bishop Murphy, give us the legacy of belonging more deeply, and now Bishop Barris is taking us to this dramatic missionary growth. It's kind of different way of saying about the same thing, you know. Let's just go deeper into our faith, because going deeper in our faith really makes us to do, of course, share our faith. You know, it was Jacques Maritano, I think, who beautifully said that faith is like a magic flower. Without the sharing, you know, without spreading this out, unfortunately, this magic flower may die, and that could be the secret why sometimes people feel they lost their faith. Well, don't lose it. Share it. Keep it alive.
And it will be alive.
And that's the mission.
So important. Yeah. For the past 60 years, the Diocese of Rockville Center has flourished and has strengthened the mission to live the gospel of Jesus as one family of faith. As we continue to grow, we invite all of you to get involved and be evangelizers of the church. If you're interested in learning more about the Diocese of Rockville Center and its programs and ministries, please visit drvc.org. I'd like to thank all of our special guests who shared their experiences with us today. And for Bishop Andre, I'm Monsignor Jim Flawn. Thank you for joining us and celebrating this great anniversary, 60 years of the Diocese of Rockville Center.